1 minute more to go. We shall start exactly at 11. Welcome to the early birds. I hope you get something better than a worm. Today is a holiday, we are closed, but poor Venu has set up this for me as an extracurricular activity, and he has helped me by setting this up, and I am thankful to him and to Sunita, who is doing the remote control from home, and all the others who are backing up for this regular feature of ours. Normally Saturday is a working day for Banjara, so it becomes easy. This time we made sure that we would not like to hold up because of the pandemic. We are not going to step out, of course, but within the confines we are definitely going to continue. So as you know, this week's topic is balancing life, time management and things like that. What we presume by this is that how do I manage both sides of the picture? One is that I have responsibilities at work. I may be a business person, I may be self-employed, I may be working for an organization, I may be a professional, a consultant or whatever it is. So I have the work, and we also presume that when we talk about work, that is also the livelihood. That is what gets me my bread and butter, based on which I feed my family and run my home and things of that sort. Even if the money is not primarily for the household, for example, both spouses are working, the husband is earning enough, the wife would still like to have a career of her own, an identity of her own, do something meaningful and things of that sort. So to her also it is equally important what work she does and what are the timings, what are the responsibilities and all those type of things. Thirdly, a very neglected segment, that is people whose work involves running and managing the home. Somehow we seem to ignore that also. A person who has to run the home, normally what we call as the housewife or homemaker or whatever it is. She has certain responsibilities which she has to fulfill. She has to make sure that, you know, children get up on time, they have their breakfast and they get ready and they move on. Earlier they used to be pushed out to the school van, now they are pushed towards the laptop so that they start their online classes. Same thing perhaps with the husband, if there are others, perhaps there may be elders living with them, in-laws or parents, so we have to make sure that they are taken care of, cooking is done, cleaning is done, the process goes on and on till the end of the day. In fact, most homemakers do not have the privilege of having things like office timings and that sort of thing. But what is concerning me is that the people who used to work outside home, whether it's in a job or even if it was their own business or whatever it is, they had a thing called a work timing. So the moment they left home, they had a little bit of a commute, unlike recent times. A few years back, commute normally meant 10, 20, 30 minutes of going from home to workplace, and then X number of hours. The standard was 8 hours. Some people used to put in 9, 10, 11 hours, and then the commute back home, and that was the end of the story. So that was work for those 8, 10 or 12 hours totally, and this was home, where you come back and you spend the balance 12, 14, 16 hours doing things which are not connected to your work. That is how the world was till some time back. Slowly, slowly what happened was, as the IT era came in and things of that sort, it started with the IT sector, but it spread like a pandemic, it spread to various other sectors, that people started working longer and longer, firstly. Secondly, more important, with the coming of the smartphones and this and that, work would not end when they physically left the office. their mobile phone would ensure that they are still connected to their boss, their customer, their colleague or subordinate or whoever it is, and therefore it started spilling over. In fact, as organizations started paying better and better, 20 years back, the way salaries went up was unimaginable. If any young person in his 30s or 40s today asks his parent that, you know, what salary did you get when you were my age, you will be surprised if it is even 10% of what this person is earning. So that is how, you know, salaries went up. Good. Lifestyles went up, luxuries went up. You had more money to give a better education to children, everything went up. But along with that came a very funny thing, which was defined as 24/7. Lot of employers started telling their employees that we are paying you such a handsome salary that we have literally bought you over like the slaves of the good old days. And now we sort of own you. There is no question. You can't say I have left the office and I am on my way home, or I have reached home, I am with family, I am having dinner. When we want you, full stop. You had to be available to your bosses, employers, even customers, all these type of things. And then the wonderful pandemic came in, where even those who were working from offices, few people even before that were working from home, but the majority of the people who were working from offices now started working from home. So the first thing that happened was that employer said, we are now saving you commuting time. And as you know, over the 21st century, commuting time in major metropolitan cities has increased dramatically. There are very lucky few people who could reach their workplace in 10 or 20 minutes. The majority of them, 1 hour, 1.5 hour, 2 hours, all this type of, you know, time period for commuting. So if a person takes 1.5 hour to commute to office, that means 3 hours of his time was spent just going to office and coming back. So when the employer realized that we are allowing you to work from home, they said that now you've got 3 hours extra which you don't commute. So we own those 3 hours also. You better be available to us for those 3 hours. Similarly, when you were in an office or something, you had a workstation, and if you wanted to take a tea break, you wanted to take a lunch break, you would physically get up and move out from there. Maybe, you know, even if you have an office canteen, you would prefer to walk down, you know, down the road from your office where there's a better place giving you some variety of food or something, or you would go and sit under a tree or somewhere and eat the tiffin that you brought from home. And that would be actually a physical and mental break. But now even that stopped. There was no way you are able to tell that, no, I am taking a lunch break or I am taking a tea break or whatever it is. All this has led to some sort of a discomfort about the way people are not being able to do this work-life balance. The impact is slowly gathering. It will take some more time before it really hits. Because as I said, the majority of the people whom we are talking about are comparatively young. So physically they have a lot of energy. They are able to put in those longer hours which are expected by their employers. And money being one of the primary factors, they feel that since I am being given such a fancy salary, I am now, you know, going to work harder and harder so that I earn more and more. Even that was okay if people realized that, see, if my father was earning 1 rupee and I am earning 5 or 10 rupees, my lifestyle has gone up, I can definitely save 10, 20, 30, 50% out of that and build up a future or something of that sort. The funny thing is that nobody in the young generation, you know, seems to be thinking about that. Nobody seems to say that, hey man, even when I was in school or even in college, I had a certain idea about how much I'm going to be earning. Now I'm earning much more than that. I had a certain lifestyle, the type of house that I used to live in. I can now afford to live in a much better house. So I should be thankful and I should start saving some of this money so that I can use it for a rainy day or whatever we call it, no? But no, nothing of that sort happened. I was amazed as I was looking around that people started taking loans. And huge loans. Earlier also people used to take loans. But those were loans which probably made them pay 5% or maximum 10% of their salary or their income. Now I came across people whose loans, you know, the principal and interest put together, what we refer to as the EMI. EMIs went up from 10% of the income to 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. There are so many young people I know who are committing more than half their salary to the EMIs. Now that is very ironical, because if a person had done that 30 years back, I can understand, because most people were working in very secure jobs. Majority of the employment was done either by the government or quasi-government, public sector, giant undertakings where once you got employed, you would come out only after retirement, you know, there was no question of changing job. Unless you really did something bad, nobody would throw you out. And unless you were a very restless and ambitious person, you won't resign and go there as long as you are getting your little increments and promotions and things of that sort. And there were so many other factors, the way the organization would look after you, take care of basic needs, maybe give you health care or subsidized education for your children. Those things were much, much more important. But today what has happened? Job security has come down drastically. Neither a person at an entry level who has joined 3 months back, nor a person who has put in 30 years of experience. Neither of these people can say, my job is very secure. I know that I will never be thrown out. Nobody seems to have that confidence. And it is happening also. If not very often, it is happening every now and then, where a person who is supposedly in a very secure job, supposedly, you know, doing good service, he has got his skills and qualifications and all that, but he is losing his job. And despite this Damocles sword, as you say, you know, hanging over your head, that any time you could be chopped off, people are still taking huge loans. Now, I have nothing to comment on the economic factor, that's their life and their, maybe they are much more knowledgeable about money matters than I am, so I wouldn't like to poke my nose in that. My only concern is that when you are neck deep into EMIs, you know that you cannot quit your job. You know that you are stuck with your job because every month your salary comes in and a huge chunk of that goes into the EMI. If the salary does not come in, how do you pay the EMI? And if you don't pay the EMI, probably your house, your car, your TV, everything is mortgaged, so how are you going to survive? Now that is what has created the turbulence in the work-life balance. This is a new phenomenon which did not exist even 20, 30 years back. So let us go into the root cause of this. How did this happen in the first place? Why is it that a person who has studied well, got himself some good qualifications, and has managed to get a decent job, he has his domain specialization, so he can proudly say that, yes, I am, you know, competent and capable in this, I am qualified in whatever field, be it IT, be it finance and accounts, be it law, be it whatever it is, I have got my capabilities and stuff like that. So I should be able to be complacent and I should be able to relax, but that is not happening. You know the funny thing? This has its roots, not from the time when you take up your first job and start earning. It has its roots in your childhood. Sounds funny, no? I will explain to you. When a person is a child, the child is enrolled in a school. The school has certain curriculum, textbooks, whether it is online, offline, whatever the classes are. But it is defined that you have so many subjects, you have so much portion in each subject, you have monthly tests, you have term exams, you have annual exams, all that is laid out for every student. Now, most adults, unfortunately, with good intentions, start pressurizing a child into believing that studies and marks is the only worthwhile thing in life. Everything else is secondary. If you study well, if you score well, you are somebody. If you don't, then you are a nobody. I really appreciated the wonderful and imaginative title of Chetan Bhagat's book, you know, which eventually became, in a different format, of course, the movie called Three Idiots. The book which Chetan Bhagat wrote was titled 5 Point Someone. It brought me back to my memories of my student days. In IIT, we had a grading system from 0 to 10. And 5 was the passing mark. If you got 5.1, 5.2, 5.3 in every semester, every subject, you have passed that subject. If you go below 5, you have failed. And at that time, failing was a very bad thing. In the first year, if you fail, you would have been thrown out mercilessly, and that's the end of your dreams of becoming an engineer or being an IIT graduate. It was that bad. Fine. So what happened was that you, to keep your head above waters, you had to ensure that you are getting some grade which is above 5. There were a lot of characters like me who were just not interested in studies. Even at that age, I could look beyond and say, isn't life a little more than what is being taught in the textbooks and lectures and things of that sort? Don't we need to broaden our horizons? Don't we need to think beyond all these daily routine type of things, mugging of this and reproducing that in the examination and getting higher and higher marks and things of that sort? But what do you do with the fact that you have now entered into a prestigious professional course in a very prestigious institution, and you cannot be a quitter? You can't leave it and run away and go away. So what would you do? You would have to ensure that you keep plodding, and complete your course. For that, you had to keep your grades 5 point something. Nobody aspired for 6, 7, 8, 9. And that is why, if you are above 5, you are someone. If you are below 5, you are trash, you are no one. So very nicely titled book, 5 Point Someone. If you are 5.1, 5.2, then you are someone, otherwise you are a nobody. Now this example I am giving you, not from the point of view of IITs, engineering and all that, but in general with our education system. So whether 35% is the passing mark, or 40 is the passing mark, or 50 is the passing mark, there is a cutoff. And every child is told that you have to have that minimum marks, otherwise you are a nobody, you are a failure. Okay. If that was the case also, there were a lot of children who have the basic IQ ability that even on the last day if they study, they can get their 40-50% marks and they can pass. But how many parents and how many teachers would say, okay, you are a person who is street smart, you are a person who has got very good emotional intelligence, you are a person who can handle people and maybe go up the ladder and become a leader. So academically, in the subjects that you are mugging up, if you are getting passing marks, it is good enough. No way. Anything and everything revolved around your marks. 40% not enough, 50% not enough, 70% not enough, 90% not enough. In fact, jokingly, I have been telling students in the last few years, don't be surprised if you get 100 out of 100 and go back home and say, Daddy, I got 100%. He'll say, no, you can do better than that. That's a joke, that's ironical, but that is what I'm trying to express to you. Unfortunately, many, many adults, be they parents, be they teachers, somehow seem to evaluate a child only based on marks. And they justify it also. If he doesn't get good marks, how will he get into a good college? If he doesn't get into a good college, how does he get campus recruitment? If he doesn't get campus recruitment, how does he become a successful person? The actual statistics show something totally different. That is the funny part. People who have never excelled in academics have done exceedingly well. And when I look back and see the toppers of my days in a top institution, hardly anybody is doing anything great. And more than anything else, they are unhappy people. What's the point in, you know, at least, you know, getting some degrees and getting some position, but basically you're not happy and fulfilled with life. So why I told you this is to help you to understand that, you know, not maintaining work-life balance, focusing only on work, is drilled into us from the time we are students. There are, if you recall, there are curriculum and there is extracurricular activities. So many extracurricular activities go to build you up as a person, as a professional, as a leader. Let's say there are inter-school debates or quizzes, or that they have that model United Nations or something of that sort, or those type of things. If a child participates in that, develops the ability to excel in that, it is such a great plus point for the child. It is going to be so useful to him or her later in life. But it has that rubber stamp which says extracurricular. So this child comes back very happy and says that I got this award or this prize in the inter-school competitions. And the first thing that is asked is, did you prepare for your maths test? How many marks you got in your last Hindi exam? What are you doing about social studies, which you say is boring and which you are not studying properly in? Everything boils down to the same. So when that is drilled into us so much, it is very natural that when we grow up and we take up this job, we start thinking that if I am earning 1 lakh per month, somewhere, you know, that video is playing in our mind from the school days. What did your teacher say when you got 70% marks? What was the remark that she made? Can do better. Next term you got 80%. Did the teacher write? Fantastic, you've gone from 70 to 80. You have progressed. 15% extra you have put in from 70 to 80 is about progress of roughly 15% improvement within 1 month, within 3 months. Congratulations. No way. The teacher still said, can do better. So that is so ingrained in us that if I am earning 1 lakh per month now, I don't even sit and visualize and say, there was a time when my daddy used to earn 10,000 and we were a family of 7 people living happily. Okay, we were deprived of luxuries and certain things which we would have liked to have, but life was not miserable, life was okay. So, if I was dreaming of going from 10 to 20 or 30 or 40,000, and here I have landed up with 1 lakh. So, am I not going to be the happiest person in the world saying that now my, you know, status has gone so much, I can pay, give some money to my parents, I can give money for charity, I can look after my family and still have money enough to save? No, nobody seems to think that way. Why? Because the person says, if I am earning 1 lakh per month, I can do better. So I want 1 lakh 20, I want 1 lakh 50, I want 2 lakhs, I want 3 lakhs. It is endless. It is that very sad, you know, system of just trying to move on and on and on. And the sad part is we are doing this by climbing over others' shoulders. We don't care for anybody. I just want to ensure that I get that increment, I get that promotion, I get that bonus. And even when I'm doing very well, if somebody tempts me with a higher salary, I'm going to ditch my employer who has looked after me for so many years without batting an eyelid, and I would jump and go somewhere else. In the good old days, as I told you, when employment was primarily with the government, public sector, large establishments and things like that, a person would study whatever degree, graduation, engineering, BCom, whatever he does. Finally, he would start looking for a job. Initially, jobs were not available. Those were the days when there was no concept of campus recruitment. Even when I studied in a prestigious institution like IIT Bombay, we hardly had any campus recruitment over there. We had to come out and we had to look for jobs. So a person comes out and looks for a job, he is told no experience. You want a good job? You cannot get it unless you have experience. So you would probably go to a small place, any company which is probably paying him half or one third of what he thinks he deserves. But he says, I'll gain experience. Only if I get experience, I'm going to then move on to a better job. So he takes up that very small, very ordinary job, but it is baptism by fire. He learns so much because every day there is a crisis. Every day there is personality clash. Every day there are dissatisfied customers. Every day there are machines or systems breaking down. And that teaches him so much about life, which if he had studied another 5 years in college, he would have never learned. And from there, he moves on to a better job. So let's say, in the good old days, a person would aspire and say, I am trying to get a job in, let's say, Hindustan Aeronautics, HAL. He goes through that whole procedure and finally he lands up a job in HAL, whatever may be the designation or whatever. He knows very well that promotions are slow. He knows that increments are minimal. But he says, I'm working for a very prestigious organization. I have job security. I have respect. I have a social status when I tell people that I'm working for such prestigious organization. So what people would do is they would probably invest sizable money and get a nice embossed brass plate with the name and Hindustan Aeronautics Limited written below that, so that even passers-by who pass in front of my house or gate should be able to look and say, hey, this man works for such a prestigious organization. Today, I don't think any youngster is willing to invest even 100 rupees in a nameplate which contains the name of his company. Probably even if he gives an order for a nameplate like that, by the time the nameplate is delivered, he has already changed jobs and he's working for some other company, right? That is how it is happening. So with this mad rush that I want to do better and better, I want to earn more and more, and on top of that, the liabilities of EMIs and those sort of things, we are getting caught in that trap where we are saying, I have to work like this. I have no choice. It is not that I want to work 24/7. Hey, I love playing cricket, man. I would love to play cricket. I would love to play cricket every evening. To make a team and start playing cricket, what a lovely time I had. Or I used to take my hockey stick and go to some ground in certain such a locality where there were children who were playing hockey, and I would request them and join them and play hockey and come back home. Now I don't get time for anything of that sort. I haven't played cricket for months, maybe even in years. Why? Who is stopping you? That is what I don't understand. We are getting caught in a trap which is within our own mind. Do not bluff yourself in saying, I have a horrible boss who is making life miserable, so I have to work. Don't say that my company expects so much work and they will throw me out, therefore I have to work. Don't bluff yourself that I need the money badly. Nowadays, education, higher education of children is so expensive. If I don't earn and if I don't save, how will I send my child to higher education institutions? Your fathers and your grandfathers sent 3, 7, 9 children for higher education on salaries which, as I told you, are probably 10% of what you are getting. I was very fascinated to read just 2-3 days back an interview by Mr. H.S. Doraiswamy. This is his photograph. This was the interview that appeared in the newspaper last week. Mr. Doraiswamy is only 104 years old. Okay. He was a freedom fighter, he was a teacher, he has done so many things in life. And today at 104, he looks back upon this entire century that he has lived in the world. What have you done about life? For example, when we talk so much about the pandemic, I know of people of all ages getting so worried about the pandemic, and he says that I have no worries about pandemic. Yes, it has been a tough year. The situation has saddened me because people don't care about others anymore. It has made us all selfish. That is what he is more concerned about. He has written some wonderful thoughts, which I would like you to look up Deccan Herald's online edition, and you yourself will get to know a lot. Finally, the point that I am raising is that please remember that if you are getting caught in that rat race, if you are getting caught in that web which says that you have to work harder, you have to put in endless hours, you have to neglect your family and all that, if you allow me to be cruel, you are fooling yourself. It is not true. Every one of us can break through. If you can't do it right now, you can plan to do it 6 months or 6 years down the line. But are you even making the plans, or are you going deeper and deeper and deeper into the quicksand which is pulling you down further and further into the thing? These are some of these things which I want you to please give a consideration. It is not something very, very great. It is not something which you cannot think of. You don't even need me, in fact, to tell you all these things. I'm sure most of you are wiser and more capable of knowing whatever you need to do in life. But I would like you to please think over what you can do with your own lives, which, if you develop that habit of balancing that there is work, there is personal life, and there is family, all these three have to be balanced together. Only if I do that, then I will be able to actually fulfill and do something meaningful in life. So this was my simple and humble message to you. I have not touched upon time management much because there are very practical tips on time management. I've written a booklet also. You can just ask the office and get a copy for yourself and go through this. One and only thing that I'd like to tell you about time management is there is no such thing as lack of time. It is only prioritization of your tasks. Whatever you prioritize and whatever you say is important and has to be done, automatically you get time for it. It is as simple as that. If you can just keep this one mantra, you will always be able to manage your time. But most important is how are you managing your work-life balance, and that automatically creates more and more and more of time for you to do things which are meaningful, which you will one day be able to look back and say, yes, I may not have been a great achiever, I may not have been a celebrity or a topper, but I have led my life with some meaning, some purpose, and I can, you know, look back with satisfaction and say, it has been worthwhile whatever I have done. So with that, can I go on to your, you know, question? Where is the chat box, Venu?
Chat box,
it is here? Okay. Right. So let me see your questions so far that have come in. Surekha says, thank you, Ali, you are unstoppable and unbeatable. No, no, please, I'm nothing of that sort. Nothing could stop you from reaching out to us. We owe you a huge debt of gratitude. Very humbled, very nice. I feel very happy to hear that. Namneet says, Dr. Ali, please mention the name of the newspaper. Yes, it is Deccan Herald, and it happened within the last 1 week. I've forgotten the date on which. You can look it up over there. Anuradha says, the social pressure and so-called norms are very strongly part of us, and if one does not fall into it, one is a failure. By whose standards, Anuradha, ask yourself that. Who will decide whether you are a failure or not? Are you willing to give that right to some people who are unreasonable, who are probably jealous, who are people who have different value systems and attitudes towards life, and they have the right to tell you that you are a failure? Hold your head up, be answerable to your conscience and to your family. We live only to be accepted by others, and don't bother or stand. The time has come to stop doing that and start bringing in. It takes time. If you have been living for others, if you have been obliging everybody else, you can start. It will take time. People will be angry. They will not allow you to do it initially. But once you start doing it, over a period of time, they will learn to, you know, respect you for that. Surekha says, it's easy to decide right versus wrong. How do we decide right versus right and establish balance? See, right versus right, as I was telling you about time management also, is a question of prioritization. I am one person who is not always so worried about right, wrong, right, all those things. I just want to see that first is your conscience. Please keep on that. If my conscience says that I am doing something worthwhile, that is the first step. Then my nearest and dearest, am I hurting them consciously or unconsciously? Or am I giving them some time and effort? Thirdly, I owe it to myself also. I cannot all the time keep being good to others and neglect myself. It doesn't work. That is what, according to me, is right versus right. Padma says, our past haunts us. It makes us insecure how to overcome that. Yes, doesn't matter. I've been repeating that proverb which says that every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. So if I have been a great sinner, from now on I have a future, I can start building up on that, isn't it? So let me at least start working on it now. Work out your past, resolve what were the emotions involved with the past. Is it guilt, is it anger, is it low self-esteem? Each one of these, once you identify the emotions behind that and work on it, you will be able to overcome the this thing. How to be empathic without getting emotionally involved. In fact, empathy is a skill which helps you to keep away from getting emotionally involved. That's what I've always been teaching for years and years now. Empathy is diagonally opposite to sympathy. Sympathy is the one that pulls you and gets you emotionally involved and things of that sort. I see a beggar and I feel so sad for him. I take out all the money and give it off to him, and that fellow may be a drug addict. He'll go and enjoy himself with the money. But empathy is a skill to be able to understand, does he deserve my money? Do I really need to part with it? What is the best way of helping somebody who is genuinely in need? How do I explore and find out what are his needs, and how much can I fulfill those, and how do I balance these two things? So So empathy is an ongoing exercise of learning the skill of putting yourself in the other person's shoes and understanding what is going on in their mind. Farida says, if we allow people to judge, they will judge us for anything. Absolutely, Farida. I have been hearing so often that I should be grateful to my husband that he is still with me despite me going through breast cancer, etc., etc. No. These people have no business to point fingers, to evaluate you, to tell you to have gratitude and all these things. Maybe if they are elders or if they are important people, just nod your head, be polite, say thank you for your advice and continue to do what you feel is right. Unlike in the past, for a person to maintain his basic standard of life on a daily basis, person has to give in to his work pressure because inflation and uncertainties. Do you really think so? Do you have to have a big air-conditioned car? Do you have to have a three-bedroom apartment? Do you have to put your child in a prestigious national or international school? These are very, very, you know, deep-rooted questions that we need to ask ourselves. We can do. There's a thing called minimalistic living. We have forgotten what it is. Ask your parents, or better still, your grandparents, how they used to save on anything and everything. If they would buy a product, they would go on and on and on repairing it so that it lasts a lifetime. Today you buy a vehicle and 3 years later your mechanic says, Illa Swami, this will keep giving you trouble, sell it off and buy a new one, and you go ahead and do that. Do you really need to do that is the question that you need to ask yourself. Vinita says, we have been brought up and drilled so deeply by hearing as can do better by our teachers or parents, which I feel now at least we can change and encourage our children by their achievements. Exactly, yes, I 100% agree with you. All of us should put our heads together, at least the like-minded people who are aware and want to do something about it, we should do that. Please explain on obligations towards family members versus oneself. This is very important. It starts with what the air hostess tells you when she is cautioning you about lack of oxygen. विमान में ऑक्सीजन का दबाव कम होने पर ऑक्सीजन मास्क अपने आप नीचे गिर जाएगा. There will be an oxygen mask which will come from the roof. That little thing will open and there will be a pipe and a small oxygen mask. You have to put that oxygen mask on your face and start breathing because the oxygen pressure in the cabin has become low. But the air hostess says, before you help a child or a co-passenger putting on their oxygen mask, put on your oxygen mask first. Why does she ask you to do such a selfish thing? Because by the time you are putting the oxygen mask to the other person, if you are gasping for breath, you will not be able to complete the task. You will collapse. But if you have taken the precaution of first putting on the mask, whatever time it takes, 1, 2, 3, 4 people around you also, if you have to help them with their oxygen mask, you are safe. No, you are getting the oxygen. Now, this is the basic principle in answer to your question about dealing with family members and dealing with your own self. I have been doing something regularly for my family members. Today, I feel like doing something for myself. I'm not asking them for a favor. Remember that. Just because I have been, let's say, you're a homemaker and you've been doing the cooking every day for days and weeks and months. You're not telling your family members, you cook for me. But you definitely have a right to say, today I'm just going out with my friends or even alone and I want to eat Chinese food or North Indian food or whatever it is. I'm going to have a nice meal and come back. You guys take care of yourself. Doesn't matter. One meal if you have to take care of yourself. In fact, you're doing a favor. Many a time I also believe that when you take care of your own self, no, two things happen. One is that you are near and dear, your family members learn not to become too dependent on you. So you are empowering them. Second thing that happens is they learn to value you. Otherwise, if you are all the time stuck in that routine and that drudgery and doing work, believe me, nobody appreciates. They think that that's your duty and that is what you have to keep doing all the time. Okay, Muna says, please explain on obligation towards life. Yes, I've done that. Farida says, minimalistic life is well taught to us special needs people. Yes, absolutely. My daughter brings it down to the last point about what she is required to do. You must learn from, you know, children like Farina, that is Farida's daughter, how much you just silently observe them and you see how much we can learn about life from them. Surekha says, how do we get rid of overthinking that eats into our peace and productivity? Well, we have to start off by practicing. Some people use meditation and things like that to do it. Some people, you know, go into some chanting or some those type of things. Some people read, you know, some positive and inspiring books. See, each one of us has got our own method, but it is possible that the more you divert your mind, the more you get involved in meaningful activities, the less you will have this problem of overthinking, which keeps enveloping your mind all the time. How do we explain the importance of time and balancing life to our children? It's very challenging. The first step in that is to be a good role model to your child. You have to start off by being a role model and not just tell your child, sit for 3 hours and study, get up at 5:30 in the morning. No. You practice and then your child follows you. And secondly, explain why you are doing it. Most children that I come across are thinking that I am just being forced and pushed into doing something. I don't know why I am being told, including from studies to daily activities or something of that sort. Why should I do it? The elders do not take the trouble of explaining to them. Please do that. Sit down quietly, calmly. Even if the child doesn't agree, help the child that this is the reason why I am asking you. Why do I force you to eat vegetables and not to have pizza every day? What is the benefit of that? Why am I asking you to get up early in the morning? How does it benefit? Let us try this out. Let us do that. And you can succeed with children if you learn to listen to them. First, listen. Let the child bring out all his or her frustration, anger and things like that. And then you can move on to telling them what to do. Navina says, leading a meaningful and fruitful life is more important than being in the rat race and regret later. I think rather than comparing yourself with others, live life on your terms and be happy. 100% right what Navina has said. But remember, we know this at the intellectual level. Sometimes we don't do it at the practical level. Unless you do it at the practical level. There's a very nice riddle which I give to small children. You know, in the lakes and all that, you have this big lotus leaf or something floating on that. And some frogs or some insects come and sit on that leaf. So the riddle goes like this. 3 frogs were sitting on the leaf, which was floating on the water of the pond. 1 decided to jump. How many remained? Some people will say 2, obviously. 1 has jumped, so 2 are there. Some are deeper thinkers. They say, no, that leaf is so fragile and is floating on water. No, so one fellow jumps, the balance goes off and the other 2 will also fall down. So there will be none left. But you know what is the correct answer? The correct answer is 3. Why? Because 1 frog decided to jump. How many remain? Still 3 remain. That is the mistake that we made. Oh yes, I should do time management. No, I should not be chasing this thing. I should bring it down. I should reduce my stresses. I should be more forceful and assertive with my bosses. It is that like the frog who decided to jump. Pushpa says, I've always encouraged my children to pursue what they enjoy and are good at. But when it comes to career choice, their first priority is money. My God. Allow them to think in terms of money, Pushpa. Doesn't matter. Only thing is you tell them that you have to know how to earn the money. It is like saying, I want to eat tasty food. Now, unless you define what is tasty food, what is your taste, and whether it is available or not, whether we have the correct vegetables, whether we have the time to prepare it or not, then you can say, yes, I want to have tasty food. The same way I want to make big money. Money will chase you. You will always get money provided you become capable. Anybody who gives you money will first ask, why should I give you money? And if you say, I am a competent software professional, legal professional, teacher, whatever it is, I can give you this, in return give me money. That's how you become rich. Rohini says, I feel it is necessary to try and be a better version of ourselves than comparing with others. Absolutely right. Strike a work-life balance. How do we teachers convince parents of the same? See, it's a vicious cycle. Parents say, teachers don't listen to us. Teachers say, parents don't listen to us. Forget about parents. Start with the child himself. No? Tell the child you got 60%. Good. Will you compete with yourself and try and see whether you can get 80% in the next exam? No, miss, it is too high, this subject I don't like. Okay, you tell me. If not 80, will you get 75? Will you get 70? Will you get 65? Compete with yourself. And the moment the child does that, give him a lot of positive strokes and say, from last term to this term, you went from 60 to 67. Nothing is preventing you from going from 67 to 74 in the next, isn't it? That's how you're going to be progressing in this subject, and that's how you're going to be progressing all round in the thing. Una says, especially my family members, as blood is stronger than water, so the saying goes. Absolutely right. So what? We can help our family members, we can balance out everything. All it does is, number one, as I mentioned about time management also, the priority. What is my priority? Is my priority to earn more and more money? Is my priority to buy a big car and take up a liability of a big EMI? Is my priority to show my neighbor that I have a better car than you have? Is my priority to, you know, become a member of the best club in the city or go for a super vacation or something of that sort? We must learn these things every now and then. We get to learn something or the other from how nature and the world treats us. Remember that also. Every now and then, if nothing else, if you watch the change of seasons by the nature, you will get to learn. If you look at the pandemic that came in and how it shook up everybody, you will learn. If you go back into the past and study history, which most of us don't bother to do, you will learn. What was the pandemic that came 100 years back, around 1920? It wiped out 1/3 of the population of major cities like Bangalore. Can you imagine 1/3 of the population was wiped out by pandemics? How did people survive that? How did people rebuild their lives? What were the emotions that they went through? First World War. Even now we are hearing about countries apologizing to India that so many lakhs, I don't remember the figures, something like 15 lakh Indians died fighting World War I. For what purpose? It was not our war. We had nothing to do with it. We were forced to get recruited into the army and we were sent off to Africa, these, that, all those places, and tens of lakhs of Indians died thanklessly. And today, 100 years later, they are apologizing for it. But if we take our trouble to learn all these small things, there is so much that helps us to give a priority. Every year we have that occasion when we, you know, commemorate Jallianwala Bagh. I'm sure most of us don't even know what happened. One of the questions that comes to my mind was, there was this horrible General Dwyer, you know, British Army, who came to the gate of Jallianwala Bagh, where there was a peaceful demonstration being held by men, women, children and all that. And he ordered that they should be mercilessly killed. And 1,000 people died on that day, all innocent people, in 1 or 2 hours. Because they had no escape. And one by one, as the gunshots rang out, people were, you know, falling and dying. But one thought that always comes to my mind is, do you know who were the people who killed them? It was not Britishers. 57 Indian soldiers fired and killed 1,000 Indians. What makes us do those things? Right from there, this question comes up. Now, they can justify by saying, we are part of the British police and they are our employer, they are our bosses, so we have to listen to their command and we have to, no way, no. Today when you look back upon it, you realize that no, this is stupid when you talk like that. But that is how people got. Obviously, they got caught into that same rat race thinking that they are loyal to the crown and they have to listen to the orders of their general and fire at whoever they have been asked to fire. So learn from all these small things. It is an individual basis. If a child is shrewd and street smart, even if he doesn't do well in formal education, it is okay. But for others who are not so street smart, success in formal education becomes, no, he need not be street smart. He can be a creative person. He can be a person, you know, who invents something. He can be a person who is into music or something of that sort. That is the beauty of it. For this generation, anything and everything has got, you know, huge avenues for people to earn money and to earn money by doing work which makes them happy and also makes them feel fulfilled. I remember one day when I was at the crossroads of 12th standard, I was relaxing on a Sunday. My father called me and said, Uncle so-and-so has come. He's a very wise, very competent, very knowledgeable person. So you ask him what career you should take up and how you should, you know, take your life forward and all that. His advice would be very useful. Okay, if he's such a great guy, let me talk to him. So I sat down very politely and I said, Uncle, what sort of career should I take up, you know? Should I be usual, no? Engineer, doctor, lawyer, IAS officer, this, that. So I was asking him that. He smiled at me and he said, Son, find out first what you are good at. And then find somebody to pay you for doing that. Huh? What is he trying to say? Before I could ask him the second question, he said, keep this in mind and follow this rule. You'll be a very happy person. See you, bye-bye, and he walked off. I felt he's a stupid man. He just doesn't know what he's talking about. Can you people, right now, today, over this weekend, think about the wisdom of those words, find out what you are good at, and then find the right person who will pay you for doing that work. You will never be unsuccessful in whatever you do. So just as I've come across so many creative people stuck in a 9-to-5 job during my skill training program, that it looks like a crime. Exactly, that's what I'm saying. If people like that, if Sachin Tendulkar was told to become a software engineer, if Walt Disney was told that he has to, you know, run a factory or something of that sort, how miserable these people would have been. Everybody who has excelled has been able to find out what he is good at, develop those skills and then slowly move in that direction. That is what has made people who I would define as successful, contented and happy people. That is what I want you people to please keep in mind. Today, because we are closed and my colleagues are not here, on their behalf, uncle's advice that I mentioned is now marketed in the name of Ikigai. That's something very inspiring. I've also been reading this Ikigai book, so find there's a lot of wisdom in that. Rohini says, when I left my corporate job a few years ago to be a teacher, I had people telling me indirectly that I made a mistake, but I still took the decision even though I knew it may affect my lifestyle. Believe me, Rohini, people will tell you not just indirectly but directly on your face. They will condemn you. They will say you must have been a failure. That's why you left. Otherwise, who leaves the corporate job and things of that sort? Please don't mind all of you. Please stick to what your conscience tells you, and if at all you have to oblige, as I said, no, oblige people who are important to you. Oblige people who are your near and dear, and in that list, don't forget that it should include you. You should never neglect yourself and do things for the sake of others. So with that, as I said, since my colleagues are not here, let me quickly wind up by telling you a couple of very important things. Number one, we offer free counseling. The time has again gone bad. We are having this second wave. Believe me, there are a lot of people who are getting upset, who are getting depressed, who are getting confused. Please reach out to such people. Tell them to reach out to us. unless whenever there's a lockdown like this weekend and all that, we are fully functional, we are working, people can walk into our academy and seek emotional support. If they don't want to take that risk, they can do it over the phone or they can do it by sending us emails to our through our website. Please go through our website periodically. It gives you a lot of interesting tips and this and that. This week I have written an article on, you know, understanding the depth of why some marriages go bad. We'll be putting that up next week on the website. Like that, we keep doing whatever we can and we keep adding to it. We also have the courses. I think by now all of you are familiar. I need not repeat. Hopefully things will improve in the next 2 months with good vaccination and the second wave getting over. So end of June or whenever it's the earliest possible, we will be starting with our DCS. Enrollments are going on. People are coming and registering. You're also welcome to do that. Those who want to do only online courses, 15th of May, we are starting with our CCAD, that is, you know, Child and Adolescent Development. And this time the focus is going to be, as far as possible, on dealing with the needs of children who are, you know, under that lockdown, because schools are not working, they're not allowed to move out. So how they are getting affected and what we can do instead of just sitting and complaining, what we can do in terms of supplementing their social and emotional learning. That's what we are going to be doing with this CCAD program, which is starting on 15 May. Please get in touch. We have a lot of lovely people in the office who are always willing to give you a smile and give you whatever, you know, friendship, if nothing else. And I would like to keep in touch with all of you. Have a nice, safe, protected weekend. And we will be seeing you again online, FB Live, next Saturday at 11 o'clock. Bye-bye and thank you.